Europe is already a superpower. How many people wrote off Germany, including Germans? You know, now, many of you watching this will be like, oh, I didn't write off Germany, but you did. The Economist had a cover that Europe is deindustrializing. I would argue, silliest forecast I've ever heard in my entire career.
So, im zweiten Teil geht's jetzt um die praktische Anwendung. Der Prozess, super spannend. Marco trinkt mal einen Schluck Kaffee zwischendurch. Wir tauchen jetzt ein in die Frage, was das eigentlich übertragen auf das aktuelle Umfeld bedeutet. Die ganzen geopolitischen Themen, die wir aktuell haben. Viel Spaß.
The fall of the Soviet Union, American hegemony and laissez-faire economics. What tailwinds did these events create for investors and the global economy?
So we've been talking, Marcus, about a lot of different things. And one of them is that the last 40 years have been an anomaly. The anomaly is the withdrawal of politics and geopolitics from the investment world. The 1970s were a very bad decade for a number of different reasons. They really started in the 60s. Pro-cyclical fiscal policy, you know, not really independent monetary policy. And so these led to some of the inflationary outcomes we saw in the 70s. And so you had the emergent Chicago School of Economics, and of course, Ronald Reagan, Margaret Thatcher, who I argue are ideological revolutions. They were revolutionaries. And then you had a counter-revolution, which many have forgotten about, which was the surprising election of François Mitterrand, where Mitterrand ran against this move towards laissez-faire supply side with a very much a Keynesian message, and he was crushed by the market. And that was a definitive end of any challenge to a domestic supremacy of laissez-faire economics. And that was a tailwind to us as investors, because suddenly the government took a step back, it allowed central banks to reassert control, and those governments pursued policies of supply side, of engaging in creating more supply. On the geopolitical front, very quickly after that domestic revolution was really the collapse of communism. And I don't think that started in 89, 90. That really started in 85, when Gorbachev essentially announced that the Soviet system was, you know, deficient. He gave a very important speech in Leningrad, today's St. Petersburg, where he argued, look, we need to do reforms. If you think about these two events, domestic and geopolitical, they both essentially came down to one thing, which is unleashing of massive supply. And that reinforced this great moderation that we think about when we think of the Goldilocks, the great era of the 1990s and the early 2000s. Now, most investors completely misinterpret these last 4 years, and they worship a false god. And that false god is Paul Volcker. Central banks really only matter cyclically. They don't matter in secular terms. And crushing inflation in 1979 and 1980 would have not worked. Inflation would have come back had there not been these twin pillars, political and geopolitical. Two things happened. One, investors were allowed to ignore politics and geopolitics because they moved as tailwinds. But two, they learned the wrong lesson. You know, they learned to worship Olympian gods, the central bankers, instead of understanding that without the macro geopolitical context, those central bank decisions would have been vacuous in very short term.
You have been arguing since 2011 that we are entering a multipolar world. Based on what behaviors?
2011, very, very few people would have dared to say that the US or China are not driving the world. You know, that what's driving the world is this chaotic disequilibrium. And to this day, especially in the Anglo-Saxon community, and I would argue in the US in particular, there's a lot of hesitancy and resistance to this. So take the Suez Crisis in 1957, where you had France, United Kingdom, and Israel invade Egypt and try to take Suez from Egypt. What happened? Well, the United States had a deal with the Soviet Union, so the President of the United States called up the United Kingdom and said, if you do not withdraw with your buddies, we will collapse the pound. The United States of America in 1957-58 had preponderance of power that it could tell another nuclear power, an empire, that it was going to withdraw from some random event in the world. Today, United States, China, Russia don't have the ability to control Turkey or Saudi Arabia, or, you know, let alone India. So that weakness is what reveals to us that this is not a bipolar world. And the other issue also is that bipolarity doesn't emerge naturally. It's the least likely outcome of global competition.
You argue that stability creates collapse. How did American hegemony sow the seeds of its own decline?
Things eventually come to an end. And when it comes to geopolitics, hegemony comes to an end because it sows the seeds for its own decline. If you think about the 90s or early 2000s, very few countries tried to subvert American hegemony, but those that did, like Iraq or Yugoslavia, were brutally suppressed. They should adopt American norms, American rules of the game, and focus on what? What did the Chinas or the Russias or the other, well, Indias or even Europe, what did they focus on? They focused on material wealth. They focused on playing by the rules set by the hegemon. But therein lies the eventual destruction of the empire. Why? Because as you gain material wealth, as you play by the rules, you also start thinking about your national interests, about your geopolitical interests. And now suddenly that material wealth is converted into hard power through acquisition of weapons and technology. And that's when the empire and hegemony starts to fray. It is absolutely true that the United States of America is still head and shoulders above everyone else. That is preponderance of power.
Why is the trust in our institutions collapsing in the entire Western world?
One of the consequences of the Reagan and Thatcher revolution has been income inequality widening. And so I would argue that the number one reason why democratic institutions are losing their legitimacy is elite concentration. The only real anti-establishment populist outcomes, I would argue, occurred in the Anglo-Saxon world, particularly the US and the UK. Now, obviously, your German viewers will probably disagree. You know, they'll quote the rising popularity of AfD and so on. But to me, like, look, Germany hasn't fundamentally changed. The United Kingdom fundamentally changed. It changed its relationship, its geopolitical decision made in the 70s to tie its future with Europe. And in the United States, you had a 2016 election that at first seemed like it was more false populism, but then descended into something else. Why? Very simple. We have a scatter plot that I've been using for the last decade that predicted where populism would be the most, you know, real. X-axis is Gini coefficient, measuring income inequality. The Y-axis is a measure of social mobility. And the UK and the US, the two adherents to social, to the laissez-faire capitalism, they had the most egregious income inequality outcomes. And therefore, they are the front, they're the leaders in this rejection, ironically, of the very revolution they gave the rest of the world. This I find very paradoxical. You know, the two countries where the Reagan and Thatcher laissez-faire revolution occurred are rejecting it the most. And it's become not just a Trumpist sort of view. And I think in Europe, there's this view that, well, Trump was just an anomaly. You know, he's not coming back. No. The Trumpian view of what went wrong in America is now the stated policy of the Biden administration. This new concept of foreign policy for the middle class. No more free trade agreements. You know, globalization didn't work for us. We need to change it. These are the norms and views of the Trump administration that live on. And so I think that that's what I would argue. It's not just, you know, policy. It's also where laissez-faire was the most embedded, without any social shock absorbers.
There are a lot of emotions and opinions connected with Donald Trump. During his period, real wages actually went up. We saw tax cuts. We saw deregulation in the United States. What's your take on his presidency, and do you think he would be reelected in 2024?
Well, also, you missed probably the biggest accomplishment of the Trump administration, which was Operation Warp Speed. It's an America that suddenly realizes that the world that it inhabits is a world order that the rest of the world doesn't follow because it doesn't have preponderance of power. In terms of whether Trump can win, absolutely. I mean, he's the leading candidate for the GOP nomination right now, according to the polling and the betting markets. And mathematically, if he's the leading candidate for the GOP nomination, he must have about 40 to 50% probability of winning. I would upgrade that to 50 to 60 if we have a recession that pretty much everybody and their chocolate Labrador expects. You know, so if that recession forecast is right, I can tell you that Trump's chances of winning are very good. And the other thing I would say is, like, look, political science is not very scientific, but what we know is that an incumbent facing a recession has very low odds of winning.
How important is U.S. National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan's acknowledgement of a multipolar world system with the US no longer being the global hegemon.
So I would encourage everyone watching this to just read Jake Sullivan's Brookings speech. It's about protecting the middle class of the United States by limiting globalization. So that's the first issue. The second issue is that in that speech, he acknowledges that the US is going to have to work for their loyalty. And I think that's positive because it tells me that the United States is now aware that it's in a multipolar world. And it also means that if you're Indonesia, or you're Vietnam, or Mexico, or India, you're like a child of divorced parents. You know, you're gonna, you know, once you get over the grief of divorce, you're gonna get two Christmases, you're gonna get two birthdays, you're gonna get two holidays. And a lot of these countries are now becoming aware that the United States and China are in competition for their loyalty. But because it's not a bipolar world, because US and China cannot punish, because they cannot use sticks, there'll be a whole lot of carrots to go around.
The US operating on the idea of a multipolar world, what indications does that have for investors?
So, as I sort of hinted, I think the number one implication of multipolarity is that emerging markets are going to be the beneficiaries. You know, and we've already seen that. I mean, the biggest problem for India is what? It's its current account deficit, which is largely due to its import of oil. And yet, in the midst of a commodity bull market, Indian equities managed to outperform for the first time really ever. One of the reasons for that is that India became a refuge for many investors fleeing China, but also because it managed to temper its current account deficit through purchasing of cheaper oil. The second thing is that as America becomes aware of a multipolar world, as everybody else in the world, Germany, Spain, you know, Japan, China, what is the real consequence of this? It's a CapEx-driven cycle. What we're basically doing is we're unraveling a highly efficient supply chain that underpins that American hegemonic moment where China was brought from the periphery and put into the very center. That required a lot of CapEx, a lot of commodities, a lot of CapEx goods. We're now kind of unwinding that, not in an extreme way, but we are, you know, we're trying to replace China bit by bit. China itself, by the way, is leading this effort. Chinese FDI is going into Vietnam and Mexico to avoid some of the tariffs of the US. But this process is going to lead to a CapEx-driven cycle. You know, and so if you're a long-term investor thinking about geopolitical beta, why does multipolarity matter to you? It's not because there's going to be more war. I'm not here to tell you to buy defense stocks, although you probably should. No, no, my point is that there will be actual consequences. Our cycle is going to look like something we've seen before. And the cycle in particular that I'm thinking about is the 2001 to 2007, which gave us an EM bull market and a commodity bull market.
How does the new world system influence coalition building for the United States? And is there a certain interest on the sides of the United States to be the instigator in regards to China?
In a multipolar world, we know from political science game theory, we know from empirical data, we know from history, it's very difficult to create coalitions. And so what the United States has to do is it needs to illustrate to its allies, namely Europe, and really just Europe, that China is a threat. And that's very difficult. You know, it's very difficult. Now, obviously, this is heresy to say in the United States, but to every European, it's pretty clear that China is not that big of a threat. Sorry. Let's talk about Soviet Union for a second. Soviet Union had over 70 tank divisions ready to burst through the Fulda Gap and take Frankfurt in 15 minutes. One. The Soviet Union financed actual terrorist organizations that blew up businessmen and politicians across of Europe. Two. And three, the Soviet Union financed actual political parties in actual parliaments that actually had an actual ideology. China has none of that. It doesn't have an ideology. Maoist ideology is a joke. It's a figment of American imagination. It's not spread. There are no European parties that are loyal to Beijing. China does not finance terrorist groups, and there's no tank divisions in Europe. So it's very difficult to actually convince Europe that it needs to tie itself to the United States. And I've been saying this for the last 5 years, and I mean, obviously, I'm correct. Emmanuel Macron, the president of France, just went to Beijing with 40 CEOs in tow. So the United States has a problem. How does it solve this problem? It instigates conflict in East Asia. It you know, basically becomes a factor of instability in a way, trying to provoke China into an aggressive action. Because through those aggressive actions, the United States can then illustrate to its allies, like, look, we were right, just like we were right about Russia. And so that's why a multipolar environment becomes very difficult to project into the future.
We recently saw Elon Musk visit China. There was a certain level of celebration. He's there, Elon Musk, Tesla. And we're also seeing sort of a PR campaign launched by the United States. They prefer de-risking. They don't want to have a decoupling. What do you make of the change of tone? And doesn't that sound a bit like the Cold War practices of the 80s?
Here we are in 2023, after everything that's happened, after balloons, after viruses, and yet Europe continues to engage with China. In fact, American-owned companies continue to engage in China. So instead of like trying to figure out who's doing the right thing or wrong thing, let's step back. Let's think about the world system. It is not illogical for France or Germany to hedge and continue to trade with China. Just like it wasn't illogical for the United Kingdom, France, and Russia, three countries in the military alliance in the late 19th and early 20th century, to continue to trade with Wilhelmian Germany. So this is something that most investors just ignore because it happened 100 years ago. But 100 years ago, in Europe, everybody knew there was a war coming after Germany reunified, especially after Bismarck was basically retired. After that moment, everybody knew there was a disequilibrium and there would have to be a war. They were preparing for it. And yet, France, United Kingdom, and Russia continued to trade with Germany, their enemy. Why? Because they didn't trust each other. They didn't trust each other to isolate Germany. And look, ultimately, this doesn't mean France is not an ally of the United States. If there's World War III, France will fight with the US against China. That's, I have no doubt about that. But until that point, guess what? France needs material wealth to be able to contribute to R&D, to its own military strength, in order to be a better ally. And that's why what I would say to you is that American companies will realize this. When Emmanuel Macron goes to Beijing with the CEO of Airbus, the Boeing CEO will go to the White House and say, look, I understand China's arrival, but I need to generate revenue. If you want me to develop hypersonic cruise missiles, then I need to sell 1970s, 80s, and 90s technology to China. I need to sell them, you know, Boeing 737s. This is a dynamic. It's not anecdotal. This isn't Marco Papich talking. This is game theory, formal mathematical modeling talking. A multipolar world leads to a paradox. And that paradox is that enemies continue to trade with one another. Look, it's 2023. This has been the case. You know, like trade between China, US, China, and Europe last year was at the highest ever. It's dipped a little bit because of Chinese economic crisis and slowdown. But I have no doubt that this will not play out like the Cold War. But the other issue is that, you know, it just, without that conflict, the trade will not end.
The US is changing the rhetoric quite a bit, de-risking. Neil Ferguson compares this to the Cold War era, playing on time, because China has a lot of internal issues. How do you judge the internal situation in China, and what do you think might happen in regards to Taiwan?
Well, first of all, let's talk about Taiwan first, and then China, because Taiwan has a very important election. And if you look at the polling, the current government, which is more on the sovereignty side, has lost a lot of support to the Kuomintang, namely because it has been too aggressive. I would argue that the Nancy Pelosi visit to Taipei was a critical error by President Tsai and could lose her the election in January of 2024. That would be a monumental moment. I mean, I'm not calling that election. I'm just saying this is actually the most important election in the next 18 months. It's the Taiwanese election, which is coming up. So that's the first issue. The second issue is that domestically, I think China is focused on its number one, number two, number three, number four, number five priority, which is not reunifying with its wayward province of Taiwan. That is not a priority of policymakers in China. That's their preference. Their priority is the China dream, the march, the steady march of China towards an advanced economy, upper income economy. And I think that they are facing a lot of headwinds on that project. And so the focus of policymakers in China is going to be on that domestic development. And there, they're actually far more dependent on the West, if not the world, than is thought. So Chinese consumers, which most investors celebrate as the next growth story, Chinese consumers are actually facing a lot of headwinds, including massive leverage that was built up over the last decade. So China will continue to be much more investment-driven and export-driven than I think investors think. And those are constraints. Those are geopolitical constraints to aggressive, assertive geopolitical action. And so I actually think that the shift in rhetoric in China, Chinese rhetoric, is more important than the shift in American rhetoric.
The idea of deglobalization is a mirage, says the historian Niels Ferguson. Do you agree?
The reason that I agree with Professor Ferguson that the world is not deglobalizing, or that it's a mirage, is that I disagree with him on bipolarity. And we know from, again, political science and from history, that a multipolar global order retains globalization because enemies continue to trade with one another because of the dynamic I explained, where creating coalitions with allies is difficult. So yes, I do think that the world of multipolarity will see CapEx increase. We'll have that, as I said, 2001, 2007 commodity bull market. That's all inflationary. But that inflation will be kept in check by persistent and continued globalization. So actually, I'm very optimistic because the inflationary outcomes I see are driven by CapEx, bound by continued globalization. And so we get into that 3 to 5% CPI range for the rest of this decade. If you own a lot of bonds, that's not a very comforting point. Long-term inflation expectations have not adjusted to my view, but it's not a 1970s view of inflation where we're in double digits.
Where does all of this leave Europe? And does Europe have a chance of becoming a superpower?
Europe is already a superpower. How many people wrote off Germany, including Germans? Now, many of you watching this will be like, oh, I didn't write off Germany. But you did. Many of you did. Last year, in 2022, The Economist had a cover that Europe is deindustrializing. The Germany is deindustrializing. One of the, I would argue, silliest forecasts I've ever heard in my entire career. When I saw that forecast, I immediately went long European industrials, by the way. So here's a couple of things that Europe has going for it. First and foremost, if we assume that I'm correct, that we're in a CapEx-driven cycle with a slightly higher inflation, that is very bad for long-duration assets such as tech. Guess what Europe doesn't have? It doesn't have tech. It missed the software as a service decade. That's in the past. It's done. That's fine. In a CapEx-driven decade, the sectors that will do well are those that Europe is actually very good at: industrials, energy, materials. So that's number one. Number two, we are in a green revolution decade. Europe has some advantages in that front. And then finally, European integration is no longer really in question, in large part because of Vladimir Putin. Maybe the next time Europeans give that Charlemagne prize, they might consider Vladimir Putin, because he's done more for European integration than, I would argue, many other recipients in the past. So Europe now knows explicitly why it's integrating. Whereas in the past, maybe it was like dubious. Why are we doing this? What's the point? Now there's an explicit answer, because France, Italy, Spain, even Germany on their own are barely mid-tier powers in the 21st century. South Korea, France, kind of punch the same weight. Together, integrated, largest market in the world, clearly there are benefits to that integration now from a geopolitical perspective. And so I think that the world we're in is very positive for Europe, provided I'm obviously correct about the CapEx implications. The final thing I would just say is that there's a valuation advantage as well. There's just so much pessimism. And there's so much persistent pessimism about Europe that you know, it doesn't really make sense anymore. The idea that Europe is about to fall apart, I mean, how long have we had that thesis? For 13 years. Finally, populist outcomes, as I said at the beginning, to me, populist outcomes in Europe have largely been inconsequential. Populist outcomes in the United Kingdom and the United States have been consequential. United Kingdom in particular, they're dealing with double-digit inflation still, and I think the reason for that is the exit from the EU.
That's great. I would say we'll take a break here and go into the next.